All to Srijan Wednesday webinars. For those who are attending for the first time, this is a community initiative by Srijan Technologies. As a part of this initiative, we host webinars every alternate Wednesday. We invite experts from different domains who talk on subjects like front-end technologies, UI/UX, mobile apps, media, entrepreneurship, digital marketing, and many more. Today's webinar titled Fundraising 101 is focused on how you should prepare your business plan and documents for fundraising, especially in a manner that suits your startup. So in the first 40 minutes of this webinar, our speaker will cover things like how you should communicate and what are the common mistakes that you should avoid when reaching out to your investors. I would request all participants to please type in any questions that you have during the presentation, and we'll take them up in the last 15 minutes of this session. I would now like to introduce our speakers for today's webinar. We have with us Pranay Gupta. Pranay is a partner at 91 Springboard, the first startup growth hub in India. It makes the job of starting up and scaling easier by providing a fun, collaborative co-working space, curated vendors, and networking events. Pranay is an IIT Delhi and IIM Ahmedabad graduate. He shunned his lucrative financial services job early to participate in and pioneer the Indian entrepreneurship revolution. As the joint CEO at the Center for Innovation, Incubation and Entrepreneurship, he led the IIM Ahmedabad incubator focusing on internet and mobile as well as agriculture. So without taking up any more time, let's get started. Pranay, over to you.
Hi everyone, it's lovely to be talking to you. I wish I could see you all, but nonetheless, lovely to be talking to you. As Priyanka just mentioned, the topic of today's seminar that I thought would be good to converse with you on would be how to go about fundraising, and especially focusing on what documents to create and how to communicate. Before we begin on this, I would love to conduct a quick poll. This is a simple question just to know, you know, what stage you're at. You would see a question in front of you. Can you please answer that? Just a reminder again to everyone. Please, can you answer the question in front of you for the poll? Great. So that everyone knows the answers of the poll, I think we have almost everyone who's attending this seminar looking for funding. About one third of them are looking at it right now, and another one third looking at it within the next 6 months. So I encourage you to keep asking questions. The idea behind this for me was to make it a lot more interactive. There is a large part that I will talk about, but please let your questions come in. It will ensure that this is more useful for you. Let's get started. So funding. If you look at funding, I think what you need to just understand is what is it that you need and what is it that you need to communicate, right? First of all, if you are looking for funding, there is no magic wand. What you have to have is a very, very good product. Unless the business inherently is good, there's really nothing you can do to communicate to be able to get funding. The business has to be good. And if the business is good, what you need to ensure is you're able to explain this in a very, very clear manner, which means, especially when we look at internet and mobile domain products, startups, you should have a great demo that you can give. Half the battle around fundraising is won if you can do a great demo. The investors will be impressed. They'll say, I can see this works, and they'll be more willing to open their portal. The second element that comes up is traction. Especially when you think, put yourself in shoes of an investor, right? You have a great product. More often than not, these will be products which are totally innovative, no one else has thought of. And half the times, every investor, when he listens to it, he or she, they'll feel there's something which is very different. And while it's visionary, I'm not sure whether customers will use it or not. And traction allows you to prove to them that not only is a product innovative, but it's something which is fulfilling the needs of customers, and customers are actually using it. So the moment you're able to show a great demo and there's a traction, you've won half the battle. After that, really, what comes is to be able to communicate that this is what my business needs, right? The first element of it is having some clarity in the way you communicate. I would encourage you to plan for a wonderful introduction. Have you heard of what an elevator pitch is? Imagine that you've just entered an elevator and the person next to you is an investor, maybe Warren Buffett. You just go in, you're with him in the elevator for barely 2 minutes while the elevator is going from floor 0 to floor 6, and within that time you need to communicate to him. For this moment, you have to plan the intro. The intro or the introduction is something which is not expected to basically get the investor to cut you a check. It is expected to just get you a next detailed meeting with the investor. Fill in stuff within the introduction which is the highlight for your business. This could be a very good team. This could be your traction. This could be how the customers are loving you. But imagine it to be a quick two-line where the first line talks about this is what we do, and the second line talks about this is where we are. And ideally after that, the investor says, hey, this sounds great. Here is my card. Why don't you come and meet me? After you've prepared the introduction, there are things that you can insert as part of explaining what your business needs and where your business is. The highlights of this could be partners. By partners, I don't just mean the team which is there, but also maybe you've, as part of your business, you have created a very good tie-up. Imagine I'm a gaming company and I'm working closely with Facebook, where Facebook is helping me reach out to the right audience. This could be something which is a clincher. How to communicate that? So plan those things out. I would highlight this again here, and I would highlight this later. Please don't Google out for good business plan templates and fill those in. You have to start from scratch and think of what is it that is the strength of your business, and when I communicate that, the investors will be impressed. And if you are in a business where you have tie-ups and partners, please communicate about that. The other is, more often than not, when you're raising funds, you'll be raising funds to expand your team. Talk about this. Talk about what are your hiring needs, what are the kind of people you're looking to hire. Maybe the fact that XYZ person who's in ABC company is the person I'm looking to hire. I've talked to the person, and I'm now looking for funds to be able to build out this team. You should be able to communicate this very clearly. And this is not something for which you're expected to open up a financial plan at that point of time. If I'm standing next to you and if I'm saying, okay, you said you need $1 million. What do you need it for? You should be able to communicate this. Next, after hiring needs, is the money needs. This is sort of extension of hiring needs, where you're saying, I need $1 million. These are the various places where I'll use it. Part of it is going to say marketing, part of it is going there. This is how I plan to market. just spending a lot of diligent time thinking on exactly how much money you need and how do you plan to use it allows you to be very clear about how you plan to grow the business. A lot of times what we have seen is startups tend to go for what I call as like standard figures. Everyone at seed stage is typically raising $500,000. So let me say a similar figure. I would encourage you to not think that way. Go down to scratch. Create your financial plan. This is something which, especially at angel level, a lot of investors don't even ask you for that. In the sense, very rarely will investors ask you to send an Excel, which is a financial plan, to them. But at the same time, if you've created a proper financial plan for yourself, it will ensure that when you're asking for money, when you're telling the investor, this is how I plan to use the money, you sound more confident. And also, once you've got the money, you know what milestones you have to work on. And that becomes very important. I can bet many of you are thinking right now that how do I create a financial plan properly? It's a chicken and egg problem. You know, if I have $1 million, I would run the business in a certain manner. If I have $500,000, I would run it in a certain manner. So frankly, ideally, I would like to create a financial plan for as large a money as I can get. So how do I go about creating a financial plan? Here I would say, think of the stage you're in and think of what would you do if money wasn't a limit and the elements that you feel confident about. So if you don't feel confident about, I'll create a $50 million marketing campaign and I'll just spend money on that, that's probably that means you're too early for that. Ask for money where you can defend why you're spending on that and what will you achieve out of it. And that's the financial plan you're trying to create. There is an element of the investor's ticket size being commensurate to your financial plan or not. So in those cases, I would say you'll typically have two financial plans. One is a conservative one and one is an aggressive one. And depending on the investor's interest in the business and how the particular investor is excited about it and how much money that the investor wants to put in, you could ask for a check which is at the conservative level or aggressive level or anywhere in between. The other element that I want to highlight here is the fact that investors are also smart. Very rarely will you be in a situation where the investor will look at a financial plan and say, hey John, you've said that you need only $200,000, so that's what I'll give to you. Investors typically want to work with you. They look at your plan, and I've seen many deals where the investors came back and told the entrepreneur, guys, I think you were too conservative in your plan. There are these places where you need to spend more. Also, I suggest this is one thing where you need to hire an extra person. So instead of raising $500,000 that you mentioned, why don't you raise $750,000, $750,000? And we've seen situations like that. So don't go in thinking that once I create a certain financial plan, there's no going back. You'll get time to modify it. Anyhow, what you're trying to find while doing your sort of investor pitch is an investor who likes to work with you, who will be adding value to you, and the person will not just be adding money to you, but also help sort of work out with you to help you think better on the business. Once you have a financial plan base, the way investment rounds are run is typically you need a lead investor. Especially we are talking of an angel investor group investing in you, there has to be one person who says, I will definitely invest in this company. And then this the same person also is talking to the other investors and says, why don't you guys also invest? The total amount of money we are looking for is $1 million. I'm putting up $100,000 out of this. Why don't you put in whatever you want? In such cases, the way it will go about is whenever you're talking to various investors, in your mind, you should quickly bracket them into, are they lead investors or are they follow-on investors? What that means is you'll come across investors who'll say, I like this idea, but I'm not sure. Or who'll say, I like this idea, why don't you do this and come back to me? A lot of such investors, I tend to put them in my mind as sort of come along investors. So what that means is tomorrow if there's an investor who's super excited about what anyone is doing. So for example, if I take our own example, 91 Springboard, if there's an investor who comes in and says, Pran, I love what you guys are doing. Can we spend some more time? He's spending time with us. He looks at what we're doing. There are suggestions flying to and fro. And the person says, I want to invest in your company. This is the amount of money I'll give to you. And this is the valuation I'll give to you. This is a person I call as a lead investor. And that's when I reach out to the other investors I met who weren't sort of willing to move that fast and willing to take a call. And I'll tell them, now I'm doing a round. This is the valuation. I already have commitments for XYZ amount. Why don't, if you want to put in money, now's the time. The lead investor is the investor who will help you close the investment round. Again, closing is critical. A mistake that we've seen a lot of startups do is just sort of keep reaching out to various investors. I get calls multiple times saying, can you introduce us to XYZ investors? Introductions is the easy part. Reaching out to investor is easy. It's getting the check which is complicated. And that's what I'm calling as closing. And to be able to close the investment round for yourself, what you need to focus is on this one investor who says, I'm giving you the check. And then collect that check and get rest of the checks in. To find a lead investor, how will the lead investor sort of come in? You know, he has to understand you. He has to understand the business. And to be able to understand, quickly what you end up preparing is a quick one-pager on the business. Think of it as a PDF or a PPT version of the introduction you prepared, where you think of what are the key elements of the business, how can I explain the business very well, and put it on one-page document. Again, this is not a full-blown presentation. The intent of this is not to get the investor to cut a check right away. The intent of this is for the investor to understand your business and generate the curiosity. So when you are sending out mail to a new investor, or you're asking a friend to introduce you to an investor, in the first go, you don't send out your presentation. What you send out is this one pager. And fundamentally, because you never know who that investor is, whether they're invested in a competitor or not. Also, why give out all the details about your business without the investor first letting you know that I understand this, I'm excited about it, and now I want to know more. The one pager helps you solve that. It helps the investor quickly understand what you're doing. After that, what you need to do is, so basically from the one pager, you've got the investor to have a curiosity, have an interest, and probably they've responded saying, I want to talk to you. Why don't you come and present to me? Or I'm coming to your office to see what you guys are doing. At this time, this is your second chance. You need to get them to fall in love with you. Typically, when I say fall in love, this is the point when you'll be using a presentation. In the presentation that you've created, again, please note, I'm not calling this a business plan. I don't expect this to be every bit of information which allows the investor to take a decision. This is a presentation. It should tell a story. When I say a story, what I mean is, for example, let me run you through a story of 91 Springboard. When I meet an investor, this is how I say. I am Pranay. Prior to this, I was heading the incubator at IIM Ahmedabad, which was one of the best incubators in India. And I established the iAccelerator program and Mentor Edge program there. And I mean, right now, there's no presentation on this, but you can replay how the presentation would go through there, where I would say, this is what I was doing. Towards the end of it, I started thinking, let's do it in a for-profit manner instead of not-for-profit, and let's try to scale it up. I met my co-founder, Varun, who was from the same school. And in Varun's case, he had just sold his startup, and various startups started approaching him, saying, why don't you share your experiences with us? The two of us got together and set up 91 Springboard. During its early days, as 91 Springboard, we imagined that we will create it in XYZ manner. Within a few months, we realized this will not work out, but we were seeing that the market was looking for the co-working part of it, and we started expanding on that. Now, we have 3 centers. This is what the revenues are. This is what the profitability are. Typically, one center for us looks like this. This is the stage we are in, and now we can see this is working out, and this is how we want to expand. This is how the story works. It's not a set of slides where I say team this, revenue this. It's not that. It runs as a story. In fact, let me show you another example. This is a startup. I think they made a very interesting presentation. Identity is a woman fitness and beauty studio. The way they went about talking of the story is they started with a nutshell to communicate the basics of the business, where they said this is a disruptive innovation. Woman beauty, what they have produced is a far superior fitness and beauty solution rather than regular gyms. The way it works is it's only a 30-minute workout which combines both gym and aerobics. It's fun and effective, and the cost of it is much cheaper. It requires much lesser number of members, and the return on capital invested is a lot higher. From here, this is something which grabs the attention. From here, they want to, this is who we are. Please notice this presentation is made for not the investor to read everything, but also for the entrepreneur to talk along with it. So this is who we are. This is what our mission is. We want to become India's largest fitness and beauty chain. They have put in an actual photo for the investor to be able to sort of understand what it looks like. They talk about how old they are, the fact that, you know, they're a running business. They talk about the market size, how big it is, why focus on women, why that works. And so there are jokes inserted here. I'm not sure if you can see it, but sort of communicating very quickly through an image about how a woman always sort of looks at herself and feels she's unhealthy and wants to strive for sort of, you know, better figure, whereas I mean, let me skip the men part of it, and so on and so forth. Communicated in a story manner, ensured when they're talking to the investor is not yawning, and investor is not distracted and looking at email. The slides, the way it communicates, the way the story goes, the investors are focused on what's happening there. After the story, if this is an investor you've not given a demo already to, I suggest go into the demo mode. There is nothing like a working product to explain what it is. I've seen a lot of startups do the error of just talking a lot about the product before showing it, it just complicates things, because when you're talking about it, the other person may be imagining things which are very different and the questions go haywire. So please do a demo here. Ensure this part of it, where you're giving a presentation to an investor, and typically this is the first presentation, this is within 5 to 10 minutes of time. I think anything longer than 10 minutes is boring. All of us entrepreneurs are in love with what we do, and we tend to overshoot and we tend to talk a lot. Cut that short. Figure out what are the most interesting parts, but make it as small as possible, ideally within 5 to 10 minutes, and practice. The element of practicing in front of mirror or practicing in front of camera sounds very kiddish. A lot of times we feel that, you know, we know our business. If we are in front of anyone, we can definitely talk about it. Please, 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 once you have your presentation ready, actually stand in front of a mirror and give out that presentation. If you have a friend or if you have a camera with a stand, record yourself making that presentation. This will ensure you are, you know how much time you are taking, you can hear yourself, you can hear your confidence while you are giving that talk, and you can improve upon that. At the same time, while you are practicing, ensure that you don't sort of make it into a rote dialogue. So what I mean is, when an investor hears the same presentation from you, they should feel that this is something that you're talking from your heart, and this is not something you've learned as a fifth class student going to a debate and just sort of speaking out whatever was written on a piece of paper. It's not supposed to be that. You should, even if you have jokes that you've inserted and you've sort of practiced for that, try and sound as if it's extempore. Ensure you're smiling all the time. Ensure you look confident, and practice this on the camera. There'll be a lot of slides that you'll have where they don't fit into the story or they don't fit into the 10 minutes. Don't worry about it. Keep them in the presentation after the thank you slide as extra slides. If an investor asks a question which is relevant to those, pull them up. Say that I thought that, you know, this question could come up, and hence I have this here. Imagine this could be cohort analysis. This could be things like, tell me who your advisors are. If you don't have in your main presentation, this could be there as an extra slide. So imagine what questions could come up, and if these are questions where having a slide to answer those can be handy, prepare that extra slide. Once you have this ready, basically at the end of this presentation, you would have more or less convinced the investor that you're a great entrepreneur who has a great vision and who wants to do a very interesting business. But from here, you need to convert them into getting a check. And this is the point where I believe a business plan comes in, because by now what has happened is they've understood your business, they've seen your demonstration, they've fallen in love with you. Now comes the mathematics of it. And there are various details which go into business plan. Prepare those, and this includes now kind of templates you can find on the website too. This is a lot more wholesome information. I've listed a few things that a business plan should definitely have, but this is not exhaustive. And definitely this needs to be modified for your business. But typically what a business plan has is the need. What is the need that you're solving? So for example, if I'm Facebook, the need that I'm solving is people have big social circles, they want to connect with them, and they want to be updated about what's happening around them. Product. So how are you solving that need? What's the product you've created to solve that? Who is your customer? And the who is your customer is a bit more detailed. This is not the 1 billion population of a certain country. This is XYZ kind of people, XYZ kind of age, maybe their profile, maybe the kind of segment they come from, kind of cities they come from, demographics, but a lot more thought gone in, where as an investor I feel comfortable that you know who's the customer you're targeting, and when you target them you're able to reach out to them properly. Also, what's the market size? Not an easy question to answer, but fundamentally what the investors and especially equity investors are looking for is the fact that this business can become massive. Typically, investors are looking for more than a $1 billion market size. Are you in one of those? Also, who are your competitors? A lot of times, what we've seen is startups tend to sometimes say, we don't have a competitor. I'll encourage you to think deeper again here. Think, how was the customer solving the current need, right? Maybe your product is new, right? So for example, I've made a car for the first time. I'm Ford. Who is my competitor? My competitor genuinely at that time was horse carriage. I had to convince a customer to not use a horse carriage, use the car, and this is how much the horse carriage costs, this is how it works, why is car better. You always, if it is a need and which is currently being solved by some way or the other by the customer, the way the customer is solving it is the competitor. You have to have your financials in place. In the business plan, don't just put a link to the Excel sheet that you prepared for financials. Put a summary in there. Talk about unit costs as an example. So for example, in our case, this is a place where we'll insert information like, this is what a hub looks like. This is a typical setup cost of a hub. This is the operating cost of a hub. This is a typical revenue. And at so much capacity, this is what a hub would typically give as a profit. Summarize this in the business plan. And you can have an Excel ready separately to be provided to this investor if required. You should talk about the team. Typically, most of the equity investors, when they are betting on a company, it's the team that they are betting on. Current status of the business becomes very important. This tells the investor instantly what level you're at. So for example, at 91 Springwood, we have 3 hubs, we have XYZ revenues, and this is the situation we are in. And finally, the future plans. You're looking for money because you have a lot of plans for future. Talk about them here. Again, to highlight, this is not the complete list. There'll be things which are relevant to your business that you will need. These could be the kind of tie-ups you have. This could be advisors you have. This could also be how you've seen the traction grow at a certain period of time. But sort of figure out what are the important things that you have. What is it that the investor would want to know before they invest? Put yourself in investor's shoes and put it all together in the business plan. I expect business plan to be sort of a final document which gives almost all information to the investor. Especially when you go about talking to investors, a lot of times you'll see investors ask you questions which you hadn't put information together for already. As and when you keep putting this information together for investors, keep adding to your business plan so that the next time you're talking to a new investor, you're able to supply them the same information through this instead of the new investor asking you the same question again and you going back home that day and sending out that information to the investors. Thank you. This was sort of the fundamental thought. I mean, there's a lot more I can talk about, but what I'll do first at this point of time is ask you to So ask the questions you have, send those in. Let's get started on that and we can come back to questions.
Well, that was a great session.
I can see some questions. Sorry. Go ahead, Priyanka.
I'm so sorry. Yeah. Thank you so much, Pranay. That was a great session. As you were just pointing out, we already have received a flurry of questions. But I would first like to thank you for sharing these insightful pointers and practical tips that can be used by organizations trying to raise funds for their ventures. So just in case you guys have more questions, please press the raise hand button on the control panel to ask your question using your microphone, or you can type them in the chat box on your screen. You can also take this conversation live by tweeting using the hashtag SrijanWW and tagging our Twitter handle @Srijan. So without wasting any more time, because Pranay just spoke about not overshooting the duration of your presentation, so we'll try our best to keep within the 1 minute per question time frame, and we'll try and take as many questions as possible. Let's just start with our first question. Our first question is, what are the major traction metrics? Pranay.
Right. First of all, I don't think there is one traction matrix. The metrics depend on your business and what you define as metrics for yourself. Again, since the audience is majorly in internet and mobile domain businesses, these will turn out to be more often than not either the number of customers you have or the kind of revenues you're generating or the kind of traction you're generating from those customers, the kind of engagement you're generating. Ideally, I would encourage you to think about a single metric which helps you define why your customers sort of are they using you or not, right? So for example, there's recently a company that I was talking to, and they are into, they have an application which is a news application in which at every screen you can see a news which is there. For them, the single metric is number of news read in a day. So this is not number of customers. What they've done is they've gone deeper and they've said, we have X number of customers, and if they're reading so many pages on our application, then that means we are doing well. And not only is this metrics useful for investor, actually that's secondary. This metrics is useful for them. They know in their day-to-day business what they are trying to solve. The number of news articles read every day inherently captures the number of customers they have. It inherently captures the amount and the quality of news they are able to generate. And sort of that's one number they are focusing on. Figure out what's a similar number for yourself in your business.
Okay, thank you so much. Abhishek, I hope that
answer. Do you want me to just read out the second question?
Yeah.
I think I'll just take them up one by one and you can answer them for the audience.
Sure.
Thank you. Okay, so we'll take our next question here. Our next question is by Abhishek. He would like to know, what is the ideal duration of a financial plan?
The financial plan, I would say ideally plan it for about a 3 years time. It depends on the stage you're in, especially if you are at a stage where you're raising angel round, plan it for a 3 years time. When you're raising funds, typically it's expected that you'll raise funds for a 18-month runway. Especially the reason being that a fundraising takes anywhere from a month to 5 months period. And if you're spending that much time in raising funds, then you should plan for using those funds and working well to grow your business after that for enough period of time before you end up getting down on the road again. On the other hand, if you're a startup which has progressed somewhat and now you're looking to scale up, that's the place where I would say plan for a 5 year period. In this case, you have luxury of planning longer because you can see that far. If you're an early stage startup where you're doing your experiments, typically you're not able to see as far as 5 years, because a lot depends on how your next 2 to 3 years of experiment go.
Okay, thank you so much. Abhishek, I hope that answers your question. If you have a follow-up question, please type it in. Meanwhile, we'll quickly take up our next question by Sudhir. He wants to know, we are in a market with excellent clients and references, have earned profits in first year, need to expand globally, and funds are needed for that. So how do we take ourselves to a VC?
Okay. If you have your product stable and you have your customers going well, and also assuming you are in a big market with a scalable product, it sounds to me like you're ready for VC investors. The best way to approach VCs is through references. So figure out people who know you well and who know VC well and who will be willing to vouch for you, and get them to introduce you to investors. The other good way to approach VCs is also through their existing portfolio companies. VCs value the recommendation of their good portfolio companies a lot. So maybe the founders of those can introduce to you. Cold calling VCs doesn't work as much. So a typical VC firm would be getting anywhere from 300 to about 1,000 applications a month, and which means there's no way they'll go through all of those and they'll look at it as seriously. So in my experience, references is the best way to go about. One more thing that I'll add here is if you're looking for, say, upwards of $4 to $5 million investment, that's a stage where investment bankers start coming into picture also. So figure out a good investment banker in your domain and you can talk to them and understand whether they are willing to represent you or not. But typically it's beyond $3 to $4 million, anything less than that, we've seen investment bankers aren't very excited about
it. Okay, thank you so much for answering the question very patiently, Pranay. I hope Sudhir benefits from your answer. Our next question is by Anshul. He wants to know, what level of granularity is required in financial plan for each spend? Do you want me to repeat the question?
No, I understand the question. What kind of financial granularity is required in each spend? Anshul, I think, so Anshul, it depends from sort of element to element. On the manpower, I would encourage you to be granular to the level of who all you're hiring for, what sort of what roles are you hiring for, and when will you hire them, and what is the kind of salaries you'll give out. But sort of on marketing plan, it's okay to be a bit broad based. So if you're saying social media marketing XYZ amount, that's okay. You need not say on Twitter so much, on Facebook so much, and so on and so forth. So depends from element to element. As long as it's something which you can explain and it's on something which is very odd, that's okay.
Okay, so thanks again. Our next question is by Pranay, who wants to know, how much do you typically dilute in the seed round?
Pranay, first of all, you have a great name. how much you dilute in the seed round? I'll give you the number. Please don't create a mind block saying, this is what the other Pranay told me, and hence, this is the only number I'm willing to listen to. The number that we've seen typically is anywhere from about 8-9% to up to 30%. Even 33% in some cases. You would notice the number I'm saying in itself is a huge range. What it also means is it depends on what business you're in and what the investor wants. It's very hard to say a standard around that. Think of it this way. The the investor is the one who will decide a valuation. And when they, if you have choices, you can go about thinking of this is what the typical number is. But if you don't have choices and there's one investor who's willing to give you money at a certain valuation, that's your valuation. And that's what you need to think whether you want to take it or not.
Okay, very fair answer. Right. So our next question is by Nitin Khanna. He would like to know, what if you can't find any lead investor? Everyone says it's interesting, but let's talk later. So does that mean I'm not good enough yet? I feel a lot of startups would be going through the same problem. What would you say to that, Pranay?
Very interesting. I mean, it just sort of... So the fact that you're asking this question means you genuinely thought about it. There are multiple reasons why you're not able to find a lead investor. One, maybe you're not ready for it. So that is quite a possibility. Go back, do business better, think through more, and ensure you get ready for it. The other is where you're not creating a deadline. And this is a very interesting trick I'm telling you. Please don't go about telling this to all the investors. They'll you won't be able to enjoy using that trick. So let me explain this more to you. Think of yourself as an investor where a startup comes to you and says, I'm doing this, why don't you give me money? And as an investor, you say, okay, tell me more about this. The investor, the entrepreneur comes and tells you. And you say, okay, I want to see a couple of customers. I have no incentive to cut you a check because you aren't going anywhere. And in all this time, I'm getting to know you better. I'm getting to see you grow. And I can still cut you a check tomorrow, right? So what is the deadline you've created for me to give you money? And one way to figure out whether an investor is serious or not is to create that deadline. These deadlines could be the fact that I'm talking to multiple investors and now I need the money and I'll sort of take it from whoever is willing to give at this point of time. This could be also communicated to them that since you're talking to me and this is the money I need, I've actually found out these three people, I'm making them an offer and I need to pay them salaries next month. So I need the money now. But sort of this, if you've had a good conversation with investors and they're genuinely interested, then this element of deadline helps. Use it sparingly. Don't assume that just by creating a deadline, you will get the money. By creating a deadline, they may go away too. So you should be able to read a conversation if you feel they are genuinely interested. Create a deadline and that will sort of help you close the round.
I think you have given them insider information, Pranay. I just hope after this session, not all investors would be after your life. Anyway, we'll just quickly move on to the next question. Our next question is by Abdullah. He wants to know, what should be the main pitch to attract investor to invest in an e-commerce plan?
Okay. Abdullah, I'm sorry, this is one question I'll need to skip because I must confess, I don't think I fully understand e-commerce from valuations, etc. perspective right now. And also, the way e-commerce investments have happened, I think I'm not fully sure how angels are looking at it and whether there are more VCs willing to take a bet on new startups or not. So this is something which is beyond my expertise and I'll let this pass.
I hope if you have any more question, you would still type it in and won't be disappointed. And if you want to, you know, maybe you should just, you know, ask this question to another person who's an expert in that domain. So broadly, I feel Pranay has sort of tried to help you out with his answer. Anyway, let's just move on to the next question. Our next question is by Arjun. He wants to know how to make business plan for multiple product startup instead of single product.
Arjun, in most of the cases, investors don't like multiple product startups, especially if these products are very different from each other. And the fundamental reason being investors want you to focus on one product. They're fine with you losing the money, letting it go to zero on one product rather than trying to diversify, saying, let me try out four products because one of them will work out. So this is what sort of I've seen mostly. That said, if you want to make a business plan for multiple products, just sort of make it, right? So I guess in the demos, you'll have three demos. Then the, you know, in the problems you're solving, you'll say these are the three problems we are solving. But I mean, ideally, even as someone who incubates startups, my suggestion is think of which is the one product you truly believe in, which you think will be bigger, and just focus on that. If you're not sure of which that one product is, give it some more time before you go to investors, figure out which is the one, do your sort of tell yourself that these are the two experiments I'll do, which will help me decide between the multiple products. And the moment you're done with those experiments and have the results, then reach out to investors. It will be more fruitful.
Okay. We have another question by Arjun. He wants to know, should we also put an exit strategy for the investor in place?
So Arjun, I know a lot of investors ask for it. To tell you the truth, we rarely put it on a deck for our startups. Only in some unique cases where they aren't obvious exit strategies, that's where we try to do some homework on what the strategies could be. But what we've realized in quite a few businesses, the exit strategy is almost obvious, and that's why I don't need to focus on those. Not sure if that helps.
Okay. Arjun, I hope if you have a follow-up question, you just type it in. Tushar wants to say that, Pranay, it's a very good presentation. Thank you so much. Our next question is again by Nitin, who wants to know, is there a formula for valuation at the seed round, or do you just pick up a number like that?
So Tushar, first of all, thanks. On the valuation for the seed rounds, there's no formula, but at the same time, it's not like people just pick up a number from the air. The valuations are a combination of doing a multiple sort of looking at equivalent deals and doing a multiple analysis. So for example, if another startup in the same domain got invested by at a valuation of 5 million and they had, I'm just picking a number from there, a million users, and effectively the valuation was $5 per user, and you have one third of those users, probably you can, it will be safe to say that maybe I would want to value you at one third of that. So that's the multiple sort of logic around it. The other is the back calculation, where as an investor, I would have a theory on when I would be able to exit the company, what is the amount of equity I want to be holding at that point of time, and to be able to hold that and to get a certain amount of return, what is the amount of equity I need to have today for the money I'm investing. The third is, we've seen similar deals at similar stages, and this has been the typical valuation for those. I think the combination of these three help the investor think of a number that they want to offer to you. Frankly, none of it is defendable. So if you tomorrow ask an investor to sort of explain to you exactly why a valuation should be something, it's not different.
Okay, I hope, Nitin, that answers your question. We have a few more questions here, so we'll try and quickly take them up. Our next question is by Amandeep, who wants to know, what could be the process or step for making first connect with investors? So do you approach them through Twitter, LinkedIn, cold calling, email, offline events? Again, I think that's a question that a lot of people would want to know about.
So Amandeep, my answer to that is, ideally the best situation is where you can get references. Reach out to people who trust you, people who've worked with you, friends, etc., who have networked with investors, and ask them to give a warm reference to you. Suppose you have none, then in that case, I try everything. There are business plan contests, etc., which happen. There are various organizations which are organizing demo sessions for startups to demo to investors. We also do that at 91 Springboard, but there are many, many of those. Like NASCOM is doing something, TIES is doing something. So that could be one way to go about. Again, given a choice, the best way is through references. That works the best.
Okay. So our next question is by Ankit. He wants to know, let us say an investor agrees to fund your business. What are the terms they fund for? I mean, how do you decide how much equity they get or how much control do they get?
This is a longer answer for probably another seminar in itself. Do look for various term sheets on the internet, especially I think Y Combinator site has a very good term sheet which they've put out in public domain too. But typically what the investors look for is basic controls to ensure they can take decisions which affect their equity. Apart from that, they more often than not want the entrepreneur to have a free hand in the way they run the business. So that's that part of it. As far as valuation is concerned, what I've seen the work, what work best is where we typically ask the investor to give the valuation. So there is a conversation where the investor says, guys, have you thought of a valuation that you want? More often than not, we typically start with, frankly, we want XYZ money to grow our business. We don't understand valuation. We'll let you decide what you want to offer. And we've not been very disappointed. So I don't know if this helps you start a conversation. This is something in which ideally if you have someone experienced standing by your side, it helps. So I mean, there is no single one answer I can give to you. It's very situation to situation. Reach out to advisors, mentors who've done this before, and while you're going through the process, just ensure you talk enough with them so that they can handhold you through the process. Every investor goes through that. You know, every entrepreneur does it the first time, and just having a mentor by your side helps a lot in that.
Okay, our next question is by Anand, who wants to know, is it required for the startup to go for investment at initial stage? What is it required for the startup to go for an investment? So I think it's in two parts. One is where he wants to know, is it required for a startup to go for investment at an initial stage? And the other part is where he wants to know, what are the requirements for a startup to go for an investment?
Okay. So the first question, it is never required for a startup to go for an investment, unless the startup requires the investment. It's a circular answer. Basically, I mean, why would you go for an investment unless you need the money, right? So if you need the money, you go for investment. If you don't need the money, you don't go for investment. It's as simple as that. So nothing, you aren't required to go for investment if you don't need the money. Now, if you need the money, what's required? Well, at a very sort of basic level, what's required is when you take the money, you should be able to multiply it and return me the money back, and I should make a handsome profit on it, right? That's what investment means. If any of you think of yourself as an investor, what you're doing is you're giving money and trying to earn a return on it. So that's the basics of it. Now, how will I earn return on it? It should be a good team. It should be a good product. It should be something which makes business sense. It should be something which is scalable. All of that is required. So basically, sort of everything that you heard in that seminar, that's required.
Thank you so much, Pranay. We have last two more questions. I think, I hope that all the attendees will bear with us, you know, for a little longer, although we have almost overshoot our time. So our next question is by Amit, who wants to know, how do you identify entry barriers, as sometimes investors talk about it?
Again, Amit, this is very contextual. It depends on what business you're in. Entry barriers can be multiple. This could be actually having patents which are defendable. This could be the fact that you've created a network effect around your startup. So for example, in Facebook case, the fact that all the people are on Facebook and they're connected to each other is in itself a entry barrier. This could be the kind of tie-ups you have. Maybe you're the sole reseller for Apple in India and that's a entry barrier. Maybe it's the kind of data you are capturing and it's hard for others to capture. Can be variety, depends on what business you're in. Just think of why would a new competitor will not come in easily, and if you can sort of give an answer to that, that's the entry barrier you've created.
Okay, great. So we have our last question by Chaitanya, who wants to know, can we go directly to Series A without seed and angel funding?
Sure. I think these sort of names given as for angel, seed funding, etc. is more of just name given for easy communication. If I reframe the question, you are saying, can I raise a significant amount of money without raising a small money in the beginning? Yes, you can. If you can grow your business well and it's at a stage where investors are willing to give bigger money, you can definitely do that. I know enough startups by now which did the same way.
Okay, Chaitanya, I hope that answers your question. If anybody has any more questions, feedback or suggestions for us, I request you all to please mail us at webinars@srijan.in. Thank you so much once again, Pranay, for such a knowledgeable session and taking up all the questions very patiently. I'm sure everybody found your presentation very interesting and insightful. And a big thank you to all the attendees for joining us in today's webinar. Before we close this session, I would quickly like to announce that our next webinar titled From Data Management to Data Analysis Pipelines is focused on the architectures that you need to put in place to enable data analysis and what open source tools you can use to harness your current data assets. This webinar would be hosted on the 18th of March by Young Jin Kim. Young Jin is the founder and managing director of Empinos, an open source technology consulting company based in Chicago that specializes in providing data management solutions to large nonprofits and the government sector. So for registrations and more details, you'd be getting a mail from our side. So stay tuned and thank you once again for joining us in today's webinar.